proposed government changes to pensions as laid out in Bill C-27 will allow defined benefit plans in federally regulated businesses to be converted to target benefit plans. In other words, the financial risk will be shifted from employers to workers. These changes represent a serious risk to the retirement security of Canadians, and the proposal was met with an outcry of opposition from my riding of Kootenay, Columbia, and from across Canada. As one of my constituents said, it is important for Canadians to have security in retirement because poverty in retirement creates a myriad of social problems. The NDP presented a motion calling on the Liberals to withdraw this attack on Canadian pensions, but to no avail. At this special time of year filled with peace, joy and love, the best present the Liberal government could give Canadians is to take Bill C-27, put it in a box and return it to the Minister of Finance, staff, bah humbug.
Last question on this. Nathan Cullen, who's the ethics critic for the NDP, says there's a potential conflict that you introduced a bill to change the pensions when you became an MP and the minister, but there's something that you supported when you were a private citizen working at Morneau Chappell. He alleges that this will benefit Morneau Chappell because they'll get business from it, and you're still a shareholder getting dividends from Morneau Chappell. You can't regulate an industry that you're trying to now change. Is that a conflict? And when did you recuse yourself from anything to do with the pension issue?
I don't see that as a conflict at all. As you probably know, I've been focused on pension issues for decades. I've been very involved in working in advocacy to improve pensions for Canadians. Before I got into office, that was an important issue for me. So we've been very focused on pension issues. They're obviously with the longer term goal of ensuring people can retire in dignity.
Hello, I'm Hassan Yussuff. I'm the president of the Canadian Labour Congress. Effective leadership of the global economy is critical, especially in this critical moment of COVID. I have known Bill Morneau as an effective private sector leader, and I've known him during his tenure as Canada Finance Minister. I'm honored and pleased to support his candidates for the next OECD General Secretary. Thank you so much.
This is Union Matters with Nicholas Thompson. Please welcome social justice advocate Nicholas Thompson.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Union Matters. It's a show that shines a light on our unions, revealing difficult but necessary conversations as we struggle to build stronger unions that can capture the attention of our membership, create a welcoming space for workers, and build the confidence to win what is rightfully yours and mine. My name is Sean McNeill, and I'll be your guest host tonight. Thank you, Nicholas, for entrusting me with the show. Tonight, we are talking about Hassan Yussuff and the Canadian Labour Congress, who on October 30th made a surprise endorsement in partnership with the Canadian Chamber of Commerce. What endorsement? Of former Member of Parliament Bill Morneau in his candidacy to lead the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, commonly known as the OECD. This endorsement seemed to catch everyone by surprise, including the CLC's own Canadian Council. For those who are unfamiliar, the Canadian Council serves as the CLC's board of directors. It provides governance and direction in between conventions, which happen every 3 years. The council is comprised of the presidents of each of the affiliate unions of the CLC, as well as designated representatives for women and elected representatives for workers of color, Indigenous workers, workers with disabilities, LGBT workers, young workers, and retirees. The endorsement reads, in part. Effective leadership at the Organization of Economic Cooperation and Development is even more important than usual. As the lead Canadian organization to business at OECD and the Trade Union Advisory Committee, the Canadian Chamber of Commerce and the Canadian Labour Congress have the pleasure to declare our support for Bill Morneau's candidacy for the role of OECD Secretary General. As the world faces COVID-19's second wave, the OECD must play a critical role in developing a broad consensus on economic policies in support of businesses and workers. Mr. Morneau is a former G7 and G20 finance minister who brings an acute understanding of the economic challenges facing industrialized countries. His tenure in government, paired with his leadership in the private and not-for-profit sector, positions him to manage the OECD secretariat and provide important leadership on economic policy issues. The endorsement goes on to speak about Morneau's plan for the OECD, speaks of vague set of priorities centered on inclusive growth and sustainable economies and a digital economy, notably absent from his priorities or the CLC statement is any expectation that strengthening labor and union rights will be a priority of a Morneau-led OECD. I'm just going to take a moment now and just put that up on the screen so everyone can have a chance to take a look at that. So I can't help but notice that the statement was released on a Friday afternoon, a tactic which Morneau himself, a former cabinet minister, would be very familiar with. When politicians are embarrassed or otherwise wish to avoid public scrutiny on something they must make public, Friday afternoons are always the best time to do it. So sure enough, it was a full 3 days or more before leaders and affiliate unions had prepared responses to the deluge of questions and complaints coming from local activists who were following along with the news story. When I reached out to my own Labour Council president asking about putting forward a resolution in response, she reported having fielded many emails over the weekend. And I'll note that I'm in a fairly small Labour Council riding of Belleville, Ontario. I'm going to spend the next few minutes going through what those official and unofficial reactions have been. And for those watching, I invite you to share your thoughts in the comments. What do you think about this endorsement? This is a family show, so it isn't a union audience. I'll ask people to keep things gentle and civil. I know we like to use our colorful language sometimes in our union environments. Okay, so let's pull up the first statement that we have here. Worker statement and the Canada Union of Postal Workers statement. Theme. And most notably, you will there. Employer, Morneau was financed. Still to this manner of strike breaking. The position of the We have the CLC saying that he, or Hassan Yussuff saying that he is the best man for the job. The next set of statements we'll take a look at here is two statements from leaders of unions. They have not, the unions themselves have not come out yet with official statements. Perhaps those are going through their internal bodies of decision making. Later on. Of course, it's also unique in that Hassan Yussuff, who was put in his seat from by his union, Unifor, who later left the CLC, Hassan Yussuff, because his membership was tied to a union that was no longer affiliated, PSAC actually extended an honorary membership to him, which allowed him to continue on with the technical right to rule. And we have not seen Chris Elward or anyone else in PSAC make mention of this fact. I do have a call to action at the end of this program tonight, in which I will call on people to continue to encourage their unions to speak out against this, to make official statements, not only in condemnation, but to specifically ask for it to be retracted. And for anyone watching who's a PSAC member, I will encourage you to include in that a request that PSAC revoke Hassan Yussuff's membership. Public employees, which is public service. Next up here, we have Mary Claire Walker, and this is the Secretary Treasurer of the CLC, and she noted in her Facebook post. But it is and you can visit Mary Claire Walker on Facebook to see a copy of that statement in full. Canadian Federation of Nurses, Canadian member, and CLC. The I'm just going to take a look at a technical issue, okay? Thank you. Well, I guess I'm not being heard while I put up my pictures, so no picture slides for you guys. You'll have to deal with my pretty face. So let's just do a quick summary of what I was speaking about. We have, of course, three major unions, UFCW, USW, and the Canada Union of Postal Workers, each coming out with official statements. Likewise, two key leaders, Mark Hancock, the Canada Union of Public Employees president, and Chris Elward, the Public Service Alliance of Canada president, coming out with personal statements. We have not yet seen official statements from either of those unions, but perhaps it is coming down through their internal channels. And we have, of course, Mary Claire Walker, who is the Secretary Treasurer of the CLC, who is speaking out against this and saying that nobody on the executive was consulted before Hassan Yussuff made the endorsement. So joining all these condemnations were labor councils themselves, which are the federated representation of unions in each of our communities. To my knowledge, three labor councils in Ontario have known to pass motions. And if you who are watching know of any labor councils in Ontario or elsewhere who have also put forward motions, please let us know in the comments so we can follow up and share that with our community. Hamilton Labor Council, Peel Labor Council, and the Quinte Labor Council, my own labor council that I'm aware of, and it's possible that a few others since I wrote the script for this show. The Hamilton Labor Council rightfully pointed out Morneau's personal responsibility and role in attacking the material conditions of working people, his sponsorship of the failed Bill C-27, which sought to downgrade federally regulated employer pensions from defined benefits to targeted benefit plans, would have set the stage for further attacks on Canada's already dismal pension security system. The company, which he inherited from his father, Morneau Chappelle, is enriched through privatization and outsourcing of employees' pensions and benefits. Morneau was so bold as to maintain a $20 million share interest in his company while promoting policies in the government which would have benefited Morneau Chappelle. This, atop questions on his use of corporate structures to hold personal property and wealth in order to shield himself from taxation in the undisclosed relationship between a family member and We Charity, as they benefited from a multi-million dollar no-bid contract, which ultimately saw his resignation from Parliament. Now, Hassan Yussuff has not spoken publicly about this, other than the recorded video he released repeating the endorsement. However, the online news magazine Canadian Dimension did report on a letter submitted to the CLC executive in which President Yussuff confirms he acted alone in the endorsement. In his views, it was justified in supporting the candidacy of Morneau, who, and I quote here, understands and accepts the essential role that trade unions and collective bargaining play in promoting equitable and sustainable economic growth. This will come as a surprise to postal workers whose strike was broken by an unconstitutional legislation while Morneau was finance minister. It'll surprise federal workers who suffered under the inaction of Minister Morneau as the Phoenix Pay system was implemented despite repeated internal cautions and recommendations against it. It'll surprise all those workers federally regulated who would have suffered under Bill C-27, which Morneau himself sponsored. And it would most certainly surprise the 15,000 steel worker retirees who have had to fight Morneau Chappelle and its subsidiaries multiple times in court to defend their pension benefits. But beyond Morneau himself, what are the problems with this endorsement? It may not be apparent to everyone, and tonight's guest will help me explore some of these ideas. My first guest tonight is Hassan Husseini. He is a national negotiating agent for the Public Service Alliance of Canada and a former candidate for the top job at the Canadian Labour Congress. Born in Beirut, Lebanon, he has been an activist in social and labor justice in Canada for over 25 years. His prior work in the Department of Political Action and Campaigns at the CLC gives him a unique insight into Canada's largest trade union body. Hassan, welcome to the program.
Hello, Sean. Thank you very much for the invite and for having me part of your show.
My pleasure.
And of course, Nicholas says.
Yes, and thank you for taking the time to speak with us tonight. I wasn't involved in unions in 2014. I'm a relatively young worker, and when I first got hired into the government, I was not a union activist myself, and I've since come into that role. So I was not familiar with the CLC convention in 2014 and what happened. Can you lay out a brief summary of that campaign in 2014? What were your motivations for the title for your campaign, which was called Take Back the CLC? And how did that message translate in the platform that you put forward?
So just by way of, I guess, of a quick background, the Take Back CLC, the message itself was really focused on taking back the CLC for workers, for indigenous workers, for women workers, for young workers, for equity seeking groups, workers who were represented by the CLC and even beyond, because all of those workers were marginalized during the previous administration under the leadership of the presidency of Ken Giorgetti, which also need to be on the record as saying that Hassan Yussuff was also during that time as the Secretary Treasurer for a long period of time under Ken Giorgetti's leadership. So that's really where the slogan came from, taking back the CLC for workers, as opposed to the labor bureaucrats, if you will, or the labor aristocracy that has controlled the CLC for a very long time with, in my view, devastating results. And so this is where the idea came from, is that we wanted to turn the CLC around and have it become representative of its different component bodies, labor councils, affiliates, whether they are big or small. And you know, we can go on and on and on about how the CLC worked and how they really didn't value the voice of small affiliates. But nevertheless, there needed to be some level of equity when you're taking the voice of all affiliates of the CLC, federations of labor, and as I said, labor councils, who were also marginalized within the context of the work of the CLC over a number of years. And so that was something that was important, and we found during the campaign itself a lot of the support for those ideas. During, of course, also the previous period of 15 years under Ken Giorgetti, the CLC moved away from being a body that coordinated, in some cases, the militant actions of unions in support of strikes and campaigns that actually put boots on the ground. The CLC under Giorgetti and Yussuff at that time as well really focused on glitzy, what I would call campaigns, that wanted to anchor they wouldn't even call it fundamental change, any change in terms of the government policy on the basis of focus groups and glitzy ad campaigns, as if that's all we needed. And they really neglected during that time engaging with workers on the ground, engaging with labor councils, with locals, and providing the support needed and coordinating it amongst all affiliates, right? So I think that was kind of another part of the campaign that we put forward as being important to do if we are to have a CLC that is effective in raising the voice of workers and fighting for what matters to workers, irrespective of the sectors they're in, irrespective of the unions they belong to, irrespective of the regions of the country, and so on. And the ideas certainly resonated to the extent that that both Hassan Yussuff, who had not or did not put his name forward for his candidacy until April, weeks after I put my name forward as candidate for the position of CLC president, and of course the message that we sent, and which was very much supported by the rank and file and workers on the ground, threatened the position of Ken Giorgetti and Hassan Yussuff as well, who subsequently put his name forward. Look, I think the idea was back then, and I think it continues to hold right now, is that we wanted to take away the choreographed conventions that were not democratic where leaders of the CLC were agreed to behind closed doors by affiliates and affiliate leaders. And we wanted to put it on the convention floor and have the delegates who were elected from various bodies across the country to make a decision on the leadership of the top leadership of the Canadian Labour Congress and the labour movement. That was, you know, another important element is that reinstate democracy in the Canadian Labour movement and the House of Labour. I think to conclude on this point is that Hassan Yussuff came forward, put his name forward, and there was a lot of pressure put on our campaign, on my campaign, to move out of the way. Because now there is somebody better than Giorgetti who's putting his name forward. Therefore, there's no need for me coming from the rank and file, because these positions, in their logic, should only be reserved to those leaders themselves, or those who are agreed to by the various other leaders. And Hassan Yussuff and I engaged in a discussion, open discussion, and members who were at the convention and who witnessed the campaign prior to convention from March, April, and May would note that we always had an open discussion with supporters of the Take Back CLC on all issues. And in turn, we engaged Hassan Yussuff on the issues. Is that if you feel that you are the better candidate, then what are the bases that makes you a better candidate? And there was this engagement on the basis of those issues. And ultimately, I ended up withdrawing from the race at the last minute, the day of the debate itself, after I made a presentation, because I felt that we've reached a point during our discussion with Hassan Yussuff that he accepted the platform of the Take Back CLC. And it was on those bases that I moved in order to accomplish the main task, and that is to really get Giorgetti, who is much more on the right within the Canadian labor movement, out of the way so we can have a new administration, hopefully on the basis of clear political program that values and believes in workers themselves as agents of change.
Mm-hmm. And I think that you kind of anticipated my second question, because I was going to ask you what sort of discussions did you have with Yussuff before stepping back in that campaign? And as you've alluded to there, again, for our viewers who are watching now or may watch on the recording later, obviously many union activists and people who've attended conventions of their own unions or of their federations or the CLC, I think it's very familiar sounding when you have an insurgency on the floor and suddenly the powers that be kind of come together to suddenly put forward their own answer, and they try to negotiate that that transition to say, well, we'll keep driving the ship, but we'll listen to what your concerns are. And so I do have another question for you on that, but maybe just quickly. In terms of your discussion with Hassan immediately after the election, was there any discussion that you had with him after in terms of what you hope to see during his term?
We did. There were some indirect discussions, not with him directly, but with folks who were working with Hassan Yussuff at that time, who understood what was demanded of them in terms of changing and turning things around for the CLC. We were hopeful initially, to some extent, because, you know, one thing we also need to recognize is that there is a cultural and structural problem with the CLC itself, and it's not limited. The CLC's strength or weakness is really contingent on the strength and weakness of the affiliates. And I think we do have a problem with the affiliates generally. Let's be clear about that. And I think change needs to happen not only at the CLC. Back then, when we called for change, we said we needed the change right across the board. And we say it again, that the change must happen right across the board. Because honestly speaking, the position that was taken by the former president of the CLC and the positions that are being taken right now, in my view, really reflect the weakness of the overall labor movement, including the affiliates. And so we cannot tackle and change things at the level of the CLC without tackling the political culture and the structure of the organization itself and the affiliates themselves. So there were a lot of discussions that happened during the campaign. There were discussions that took place after the campaign itself. And there were people who went to the CLC to work at the CLC and hopefully move that ship around. But I think things bogged down fairly quickly, I would say, in terms of moving that ship around. And instead of seeing, you know, one of the things that Hassan Yussuff said at the time of the campaign is that in addition to the air war, and that was an analogy because of the ads that they were putting, in addition to the air war, he would engage in a ground war, and that is putting boots on the ground to fight the good fight against employers and bosses and the capitalists, right? Well, and we didn't see any boots on the ground anywhere.
Well, and let's jump in there, because I think we've heard that a number of times, and my next question was going to be, in terms of the CLC, in this moment right now, his statement aside, has anything changed? And I'll just kind of put a caveat to that. You know, I think that this idea that we can run big glossy campaigns and do boots on the ground, we work with finite resources, and you have to decide where your dollars go, because it's all well and good to say that we want boots on the ground, or we encourage mobilization, we encourage street protests, and you know, there's a big rally in Toronto and the leader of the CLC shows up and the leader of the OFL shows up and they're on the ground and they're waving the flag. That's all well and good, but in terms of sustaining boots on the ground as a strategy, that actually requires money. And that means that you have to pull the money from somewhere that it's already being spent. So from your own perspective right now, has anything changed about the CLC? Has it gotten worse? Has it gotten better?
I think the old show is continuing. One of the planks of the Take Back CLC at that time was to actually shift money from those glossy campaigns and even the over number of staffs that they had at the CLC in terms of not reps, but the political staff of the president himself.
Yeah.
We had said that we need to shift from those priorities and put that money into labor councils, put that money into the local and regional level, where we can actually put those boots on the ground through hiring organizers. None of that happened. None of that changed, in fact. And unfortunately, it continued and it's continuing. And the CLC is actually running most of its campaigns on the basis of focus groups and listening to pollsters instead of the rank and file workers who are facing the bosses on daily basis in the workplace.
So obviously we could talk forever about this one
Indeed.
Subject, because it is really the meat and the core of the problems with our union movement in general, I would say, not just about the CLC, but about each of the federations and each of the major unions and the choices that they make in keeping money at the top rather than the more chaotic solution, which is to put it down towards the ground. And it means that you get less control over what happens, you get less control over what the outcomes are, but it's all in the name of building mobilizing base. I'm going to be talking a little bit more about that with my next guest, Anna, but before I let you go, Hassan, I know that you spoke about this on Twitter a number of times, and in speaking with you just before the show, I learned a little bit more about what your motivations were in highlighting this. So I think that some are a little interested in perhaps the more salacious question of why Hassan did what he did from a personal level, given the fact that he's not running for re-election. But I'm more interested in the how of the question. About a year ago, CLC Executive Vice President Donald LaFleur was publicly rebuked and placed on disciplinary leave for having attended a trade union conference in Syria. The argument then was that a CLC officer ought not act in such a way personally that would imply a political position of the CLC officially. We have seen statements now from Secretary Treasurer Mary Claire Walker and several key leaders of the Canadian Council who have stated clearly that this endorsement was not discussed among the executive or council, let alone supported. Is there something about the current culture or structure of the CLC that is enabling this sort of high-level politicking? And do you think it is an issue worthy of continued discussion?
Yes, I think, as I said earlier, I really do believe that Hassan Yussuff felt emboldened in a number of ways. Number one, he's leaving anyway. He's not continuing. So he doesn't give a damn, really. Honestly, I think he checked out, number one. Number two, I think he's indirectly emboldened by the fact that the rest of the labor movement, the affiliates, really do not have a much better vision, political vision for where we're going. And therefore, he feels that he could take positions on his own, which is contrary to the policy of the CLC itself and the leader of the CLC, who should be speaking for all the affiliates, not on his own behalf. But also, and third point is that Hassan Yussuff is very ambitious. And Hassan Yussuff is looking to be appointed to the Senate by the Trudeau government. And so that was a big favor that he did for the Trudeau government by endorsing Morneau for the OECD. And he's hoping for some payback. Let's be clear about it. This is the opportunist, careerist politics that we have so many of in the labor movement, not only at the CLC, but right across the board, that we need to challenge and we need to put an end to, frankly. And I think it should be challenged every step of the way. I'm very happy to see a lot of labor leaders and organizations and affiliates coming out and criticizing, but they need to put their money where their mouth is, and they need to seek the change at the level of the CLC and in their own organizations that gives more power to the rank and file, to the workers themselves, as opposed to the back deal shenanigans that they continue to engage in right across the board. The unions are not all created equal, and there are some that are way better than others, absolutely, but there are problems everywhere on so many different levels that we in the rank and file certainly need to challenge. With respect to Donald Lafleur, that was what Hassan Yussuff did right now versus what the way he disciplined Donald Lafleur for speaking out against war and economic sanctions, which is another form of war, economic war, for the people of Syria, Venezuela, Bolivia, and other countries and Iran that were facing sanctions. He was disciplined for that because he didn't seek prior approval from the CLC president and the structure of the CLC. Yet we have now the president of the CLC doing even worse because he clearly went against the interest of the working class, of the affiliates, of his own executive, and spoke and supported a person for the leadership of the OECD that is the worst of neoliberal politicians we have, that is mired in corruption, and worked and made the endorsement in cooperation with our class enemy, the Canadian Chamber of Commerce, right? So no matter how you look at it, what Hassan Yussuff did versus what Donald Lafleur did, they're not comparable. Hassan Yussuff should be disciplined and he should resign immediately. But before he does that, he owes Donald Lafleur and the people that Donald Lafleur was supporting in Syria and Iran and Venezuela and other countries an apology. That should be the policy of the CLC. And we should engage in a discussion about war and economic strangulation that Morneau and Trudeau and others have supported. It's very disappointing, really, really disappointing. And I hope that the pressure continues to mount on Hassan Yussuff and the CLC and anyone within the labor movement who dares to engage in such petty, careerist, unprincipled politics, the likes that we saw recently from the president of the CLC.
Well, Hassan, what's not disappointing is having a discussion with you. It's the first time I've talked to you. I really enjoyed it. I might have you back on, squeeze you on again, but we are running pretty good time here. So I'm going to throw you backstage and bring on my next guest. If we don't speak again, I'll see you on Twitter, and I'll hopefully see you at a future convention. It's really a pleasure. Thank you. My next guest is Anna Ainsworth. She is a vice president of OPSU 560 and OPSU Region 5 executive board member. She teaches liberal studies at Seneca College and has an academic interest in political violence, migration, and displacement, and an activist interest in fighting austerity, privatization, and precarity. Anna, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Sean. This has been such a wonderful time listening to everything Hassan has to have to say. And so I have so many new thoughts now based on what he's had to say, but I'll let you pose your questions and we can go from there.
Well, and this will be the first question. We'll make that easy for you. What is your reaction to this endorsement? Does it surprise you, or is there anything about it that is familiar to the political strategy at the CLC and our major unions today?
So I'm going to be very candid. I have been a rank and file activist in my locals, and that was QP, and now is OPSU, for many years. But I've only become provincially and federally active in a very recent while. And so I have heard lore of how things are done. And I can't speak to firsthand experience per se, except that in the last roughly 3 to 5 years, I have been observing a political culture at these centralized institutions that seeks to centralize power, appease the often right-wing governments in power, and if not right-wing, then neoliberal governments in power, with the auspices of ostensibly serving workers. And I have found that deeply, deeply troubling. I have also observed that there is a lack of grassroots engagement and a lack of grassroots democracy in institutions that frame themselves as fundamentally democratic in the labor movement. So in my observation, in the short time that I have been observing at a broader scale, what Hassan has to say feels congruent with what I've observed.
Mm-hmm. And I gave you a bit of a heads up ahead of this meeting tonight that I was going to ask you to go outside of your union work and kind of dig into your doctoral research and your academic interests. So in my own research of your background, I noticed that you wrote your doctoral thesis on the Rwandan diaspora in Canada and that you are interested in the interplay between political violence and human displacement. The OECD plays a crucial role in maintaining the economic arrangements which allow American and Western hegemony. And for Canada, this often means profiting from resource extraction in the global South and then benefiting from the displacement that the political violence causes. And this would take the familiar form of temporary foreign workers and refugees who come to Canada and work underpaid, insecure, non-unionized, and undesirable jobs. So I'm stretching a little bit to get back around to the topic at hand, but do you see a conflict between the interests of workers abroad and organized labor in Canada, whether that's a real conflict or a conflict such as the CLC and our union movement exist today?
So that's, I'm going to try to unpack a little bit of that. You framed so many excellent questions, and I'm probably only going to be able to answer a few of them. But to begin with, I want to start talk about the OECD and its role in neoliberal hegemony and neoliberal globalization worldwide. 37 states are members of the OECD, and since 1961, the goal of the OECD has been to sustain what was then capitalism. Now we frame it as late modern capitalism. But either way, the goal has evermore been to penetrate into other economies with capitalist ideologies. And increasingly, as we entered into the neoliberal era, with capitalist ideologies that fundamentally are moving away from state function towards quasi-state functions of corporations and turning corporations into persons who have greater power than actual human beings, and allowing them ever greater capacity to exploit human beings in all sorts of places. The OECD fundamentally supports that project by its very ideology, by the very formation of what it does, and it is fundamentally about furthering that ideology. It is not an organization that serves the workers of the world. It is not allied with the workers of the world. And I know had read the statement, but as you were posting the statement again this morning, it's evening, it's been a day. I also noticed what you pointed out as absent in the statement in support of Bill Morneau. Union and labor rights. At no point has the OECD in its history of existence ever supported union and labor rights? That is not its prerogative, and it is certainly quite contrary to the ideas that have shaped it and to the ideologies that continue to foster it. The language of inclusive growth was really curious as well. I had noted that previously and had not really been able to turn my mind to it because I've been preoccupied, but inclusive of whom? Right? Inclusive of other economies and other peoples whom we're going to exploit ever further? Is that what we mean by inclusive? Because that's a highly problematic language of inclusivity. So the OECD being supported by the CLC in principle, I find deeply problematic. And then to boot, to have Bill Morneau as the candidate put forth, the former finance minister of the Labour government, of the Liberal government, who, as we've covered, the bills that he has promoted, which have all been fundamentally harmful to workers, is equally deeply problematic. The lack of actual political engagement with the membership at any level, as we're now learning, is further problematic. So I see a number of layers of issues around this endorsement. In terms of the question that you pose of international labor and labor rights and migration and the abuse of international labor, the OECD endorses policies that allow for Canada to abuse the labor of migrant workers. We have been turning a blind eye to this collectively for a long time. And it's really just now that we as a labor movement have started to pay a bit of attention. And that's thanks to some really excellent activists who have been pointing out that we still require the labor of migrant laborers who are underpaid and undervalued. And because of global economic structures, are economically forced to continue to engage in migration for seasonal work in Canada. And they arrived here during COVID for seasonal work and were offered no supports, even though they had to self-isolate for 14 days. None, neither financial, nothing. And it was only thanks to the activism of labor activists and community organizations that supported them that they were offered care packages and support systems for healthcare and so forth. We are not only abusing the labor of these individuals collectively, we are placing them in fundamentally dangerous positions, all for the economic logic that fosters the system that we are supporting when we support the OECD.
Very clear and excellent response to my perhaps a little bit confusing question. I really enjoyed that. You made a lot of sense to me. I hope you did to our viewers. And of course, for our viewers, this is such a difficult topic because as an individual, you're like, well, how do we change this, right? Like, I want to do something. First of all, if you're potentially going to be a CLC convention delegate, if that's something that is within your area of influence, consider when you are going to convention, any convention, that you're caucusing with people who want to talk about reforming and resetting our union's positions on international affairs in general. You know, I will speak candidly for myself as a PSAC member. There's going to be a webinar coming up soon on some social solidarity fund work that was done in Guatemala. I have absolute respect for the people who participated in that. They do it with their hearts, and they put what they can into something that's important. But let's also consider that PSAC is affiliated with the CLC, who is a member of the OECD, and therefore is endorsing. Through implication, it endorses anything the OECD puts forward, and many of those policies directly harm those Guatemalan workers. It's exactly the reason why our PSAC activists are heading down there to try and support and learn from them, because often their rank and file game is much better than ours as a result of necessity, not by choice. So question three, I don't believe we've met and we don't know each other, but in looking at your social media presence, you were immediately familiar to me as an engaged, enthusiastic activist doing what I like to call the legwork of our union movement. I see photos of Fight for 15 and you're sharing posts in solidarity with Indigenous peoples, raising awareness about various social and economic issues. And showing up to carry out the political discussion and the education that is necessary among our working class for our unions to thrive. So given all of that, where do you see the role of the CLC in relation to the work that you do on the ground in the union movement? Is the CLC's approach to political action working for you and from your perspective?
I'm going to encompass more than just the CLC. I'm going to encompass in my answer the CLC, the OFL, my own union, other national and provincial unions. I think that the union movement in general has become too corporatist, too much and far too willing to align themselves with corporate interests, and corporate interests have never served working class interests or workers. I shouldn't say working class in the sense that I am not working class. I'm a college professor. I make a decent income, so I don't appropriate that identity. But I am also a worker, and we are all workers. And none of these organizations in this historical moment, I believe, actually meet the needs that we have collectively. And those collective needs are subsumed under corporate needs. The desire to appease, the desire to play nice, so to speak, the desire to be very civil with organizations that treat us with such utter disdain, and systematic systems that do not value workers. In fact, seek to destroy what we do and who we are in favor of valuing capital over us. So that's a umbrella statement, but it is how I feel. The work I do myself is fundamentally about grassroots, because I believe in the power of us collectively. I believe in the power of all of organizations like 15 and Fairness that I've learned an immense amount about organizing on the ground from. And 15 and Fairness is remarkable in that it seeks out as its leaders, senior citizens, new migrants, students, and fosters their leadership, bringing in really powerful, strong voices that have a really, really critical and thoughtful analysis of what's going on, both on the ground, provincially, federally, and globally. And I'm really inspired by those movements. And so I hope, and more than hope, I'm going to push for that our organizations that represent us as workers learn more from those movements and take a step back and consider what it is that they're supposed to be doing. Why did we form them in the first place? And reconsider their compromise that they have given to capital.
Very excellent. And I'm going to bring Hassan back on here. And just have some final thoughts from both of you. Okay. Hassan, do you some final thoughts in general, or any reaction that you had from anything that you heard from Anna?
I wholeheartedly agree with everything that Anna said, and especially the last point she made. The movement, our labor movement, where it should be a leader, it has actually abandoned that leadership of not only members organized within various affiliates, but certainly the working class generally. And I think that they can learn a great deal from organizations such as the Fight 15 or for 15 and Fairness and other groups in order to reconnect again, not only with the rank and file, which is critical in their own unions, but also make that connection with the broad working class, those workers that are unorganized, the migrant workers, the most vulnerable in our society, the unemployed. We used to do work with unemployed workers in the past and so on. We've abandoned all of that. And we've abandoned all of that for something called respectability. I don't know what the heck it is, for some glitzy campaigns. And that hasn't served us well. So we need to go back, A, to our roots. But we, and I agree again with Anna's point, we need to learn from the new movements that are really leading in many respects, showing the way.
If I can just interject before I go to Anna for your final thoughts. It's when I saw that statement originally, because I saw the CLC post that, like within seconds of it going up, I was scrolling through Twitter. And it's times like that where I just get so angry with, like, because like I spend my after hours doing this. And much like yourself, Anna, I am a well-paid worker, but I am a worker. And I understand that my comfy existence is only through fighting for it, and that it will doesn't take that much for it to deteriorate. That's why I spend my volunteer time outside of work doing things and trying to connect with people and trying to support what other people are doing. And then you see something like that and you throw your hands up in your air and you almost ask the question, why do I even bother? But having talked to both of you guys tonight, it's one of those moments where it makes me feel really good. And you get that like endorphin rush of listening to people and you're agreeing with them. And you're like, yes, there is a path forward. I'm not crazy. There's lots of us. And that's just with the two of you on the screen. And for anybody who has been to a convention, you know, it's that much more powerful when you hear it on a convention floor. If you haven't been to a convention or a conference, I strongly encourage that you figure out how to get there, reach out to your network and ask how you can be supported to get to a convention or a conference, because that's where we actually do have the ability to change the structures and the culture inside of our unions. It is very hard work, but both of you have made very strong cases as to how it can be done. Anna, do you have any closing thoughts?
My closing thoughts would be that despite my disappointment with the CLC and the position that has been taken by Hassan specifically, I don't want to say leadership anymore because some members, specifically Maria Clark Walker, have spoken out against it. So specifically the leader, despite my deep, deep disappointment and frankly hurt, I feel wounded by that. It's kind of one of those blows to the gut where you don't expect such a betrayal of trust from an organization that represents all of us domestically and internationally. Despite that, I still have faith in the power of our ability to work collectively. And I still believe that it is more important for us to build the House of Labor from the ground up, but to sustain the House of Labor, not to break it up.
Hear, hear. Anna Ainsworth, Hassan Husseini, thank you very much for joining us tonight. I hope to see you on the program again or see you on the convention floor and elsewhere in our activist lives, okay?
Thank you so
Thanks
much.
Thanks to you and Nicholas.
Thank you. So I want to close tonight's program with a brief reaction to a comment that I received from a national union president who I reached out to while booking guests for this program. They told me, quote, simply, I don't believe in, as they say, washing our dirty laundry in public. Friends, I invite you to share in the comments your own reaction to this. Have you heard this comment before? How does it make you feel? Is it a fair defense? For myself, and especially as a young labor activist, and for activists of any age who conduct their union activities on a volunteer basis, while maintaining a career, I find this comment grossly offensive. The CLC was glad to air its dirty laundry in public when it rebuked and then disciplined Donald LaFleur for following his personal convictions on a matter of international worker solidarity. Unifor, the union which put Hassan Yussuff in its top position in the first place, was happy to air their dirty laundry when it disaffiliated from the CLC when it was told it couldn't raid other unions with impunity. What is the point of this statement other than to gatekeep who gets to participate in difficult discussions? For our activists on the ground, those like you and me, who spend volunteer time trying to build or rebuild a workers' movement that is connected to the struggles of workers on the ground, which captures the imagination of workers and inspires them to join together in real mass struggle? What does this attitude of keeping the affairs at the top of our unions cordoned off from those at the bottom, what does it do to us? Sadly, much of the damage in this case has already been done. The statement can hardly be retracted in any meaningful way. Morneau and the Chamber of Commerce have gotten what they needed, a signal from our labor movement that it will not or cannot resist whatever austere neoliberal policies that a Morneau-led OECD will promote and which will gladly be adopted as policy by whichever liberal or conservative government leads us. But as trade unionists, we're used to fighting from a disadvantaged position. So I implore each of you to act now. Go to the website and social media of your union and your union president. Have they made a statement condemning this endorsement, and does it call for the CLC to retract its endorsement? If your union has not made an official statement, make use of your internal communication network to let them know that this is important to you. This could mean writing to the president directly or contacting your regional executive vice president or someone else appropriate who can hear feedback and channel it to the national union body, which governs official statements of the union. Involve your fellow activists and members in this process. If you are a PSAC member, make use of your union, local, and your regional area council to put forward resolutions demanding that Hassan Yussuff's membership card be revoked. Any friend of Morneau is no friend of public service workers. If you sit on a labor council or are connected to someone who does, ensure that they pass a resolution condemning the endorsement and demanding that it be retracted. Friends, this sort of coordinated action is exactly the practice we need to become more unified in our struggles. It is unfortunate that the circumstances are such that we are facing inward, airing our dirty laundry, as some would say, in acting in this moment, but this does not make us weaker, it makes us stronger. Tonight we heard from Hassan Husseini and Anna Ainsworth, and they had clear, unequivocal statements as to why the CLC needs to not only retract its endorsement of Bill Morneau, but go even further and withdraw its participation in the OECD. And I personally endorse both of what they had to say. We need to critically reflect on what role and culpability our union movement is playing in both maintaining and accelerating the policies at home and abroad that result in anti-union, anti-worker politics, and austerity. So I encourage anybody who joined late to please go back and listen to what they had to say. I apologize for the technical delays at the beginning of the program. And I encourage you to continue to stay tuned to Union Matters. Thank you very much, Nicholas Thompson, who is our host and was my producer tonight, helping me out with the technology. And I hope everybody has a great rest of their November. Stay safe and have a good evening.